great to be here with you today. In my experience with the Electrochemical Society, I've had a lot of influence in the impact that you've had, your contributions to our meeting, and the great experience of your Nobel Prize that we'll talk about a little bit later. But we'd like to start this by going back to your childhood, early days, and the things
out
that influenced.
Out of my present second childhood.
That's right. your early days and the things that influenced you and maybe started moving you towards scientific interests.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. As I was growing up, I never consciously thought I was going to be this or that. I mean, somehow I just propelled along. And it's true that when I was in a baby carriage and we lived near McGill University in Montreal, and my mother used to wheel me, so she told me, on the campus grounds and tell me that I was going to go to, this, I'm a baby, going to go to McGill University. And I assume that was because two of my uncles were medical students at the time at McGill. So, you know, there's a precedent for it. But I, apart from that, I don't know that that had any effect in my later life. I don't know that I even thought much about a career at any point. I think not even in high school or something. But always as a child, I think far more than a chemistry set, I think what influenced me was building things. You know, there are all sorts of tinkered toys, erector sets, mechano sets, and so on. And so I used to almost spend my, and jigsaw puzzles, I used to spend a lot of time almost incessantly just doing these puzzles. And I think that maybe more than any chemistry set, of course, as a child I had a chemistry set, but the experiments weren't very interesting, making soap or something. But I think probably more than that, more than any chemistry set, that was the sort of thing, you know, that there are puzzles out there, they're putting things together, and I think that's probably how I got into what you might call science, without consciously trying to get into science. On the other hand, when I went to high school, I went to regular high school, a very good high school, and at 10th grade, there's a choice the students had to make. This is, you started eighth grade there at that time in Montreal. At 10th grade, you had to make a choice whether you wanted to continue with Latin, we had had 2 years of Latin in high school, or whether you wanted to sort of take more math courses. And even though Latin, I guess, was officially my best subject, I didn't even give it a thought. I naturally just went into sort of the mathematical sciences sort of thing. So, and that's without any real thinking. It was just almost automatic, you know, that, and I certainly wasn't thinking in terms of any career, anything mm-hmm. like that.
So, an aptitude. And
an aptitude for, probably for math, mm-hmm. because I did pretty well in math. It wasn't for physics because I just didn't like the physics course that we had, which was in gears and pulleys and tension. Later on at McGill, I did reasonably well in electricity and magnetism course. But somehow all that combination of tension, all these pulleys, somehow I didn't quite grasp it. So I didn't like the physics course. The chemistry course was, of course, were fine, and the math courses were fine. And the teachers were, I think, a very caring sort of thing. I mean, some were maybe a bit odd in one way or another, but it was a good atmosphere. And there were a lot of excellent students there, and some that weren't so excellent. So, it was a kind of competitive environment, too, I imagine. At least I know in those days you had to pay to go to high school unless you won a scholarship. And each year I won a scholarship, so I didn't have to pay. But you know, these things just evolved naturally without any big decision made. I mean, it was just natural that I would sort of go into science without even thinking about it, probably reflecting this love of construction of things, building structures together. Of course, that may be true of many other subjects.
You sure too. Your mother wasn't planning subconscious messages about it?
I don't think so. I remember when I finished public school, she did come to collect a medal that I had earned, and I was embarrassed by that because I think she was afraid I might lose it on the way home.
Well, if she planted the one about McGill, it puts you in a good place, certainly a world-class
Yeah,
university.
Well, of course, it was a natural place to go because we were living in Montreal, and this way I could stay at home, and so there was never any thought about going to any place other than McGill. And McGill was a good experience. It was during the war, and so the staff was relatively low, at least those in the science. So for example, Otto Mass was a famous physical chemist at McGill, but he was in charge of science up in Ottawa, so he rarely came in to McGill at the time. It was a dedicated group of teachers. Then it was natural at that time, without any thinking about it, to go on for your PhD, if that's what you won't, and to stay at the same place. Mm-hmm. And in fact, at that time in Canada, there are only two universities that gave PhDs in chemistry, McGill and Toronto. So if you were on the East Coast and you went to one of those universities or any place in the West, you would typically come to McGill or Toronto. And so we had in graduate school loads of people, especially from the West, but also a number from the Maritime provinces also.
But anything in particular that led you to the PhD in chemistry?
Early on when I went to McGill, I had to make a decision whether to go into, without any thinking, I was going to go into science. I mean, no thought at all, just automatic. I had to decide whether to go into chemistry or physics, and remembering my experience with these damn pulleys and whatever, I picked chemistry. I think it turned out well, because I think later on, in the way the career development, I think I had an easier time in chemistry than I would have had in physics, I think. So that was a stroke. Those pulleys were a stroke of luck.
But you didn't have an easier time once you left McGill.
No, up to a point I had, because they speeded up the undergraduate so that the student chemists can go into war research early on. So we saved a year by doing it in the summer. I mean, a bunch of us at McGill, I'm sure at other universities. And so that meant that I got my bachelor's in the fall of 1943. The natural thing, since there are only two universities that gave PhDs, was to continue on at McGill. So again, without any thinking about a career or anything, I just continued on at McGill. The professor that I worked with had a large group. He was a person who got his degree at McGill and then got an extra degree at Oxford, working with C.N. Hinchelwood and so on. So, you know, he knew something about good research, what have you. Anyways, as students, as graduate students, we all adored him. He'd go out to lunch with us, you know, with some greasy spoon. And I mean, it's just a marvelous experience, and a very kindly person and very hardworking. And I remember, as students, we were very unsophisticated, and we were in awe that he would take his briefcase home every day. He actually worked at home sometimes at nights. I mean, you know, we weren't all that hardworking, I guess. That was for us. I mean, now it'd be standard, but to us, that was a novelty.
After
After that, then I went up to the National Research Council of Canada, and that was automatic too.
But wasn't, you know, didn't you have some obstacles in really getting moving on your career?
Not at that point.
Yeah.
There was a chap who had worked for Winkler and who was now up at the National Research Council of Canada, which is becoming a premier place for research. And they had developed a new postdoctoral program, which at that time they called junior research fellows, because so I went up there as a junior research fellow. it wasn't called a postdoctoral, but that's what it was. Anyways, he had worked for Winkler, so he came down to Winkler's lab to see if there were people interested in going up as postdocs. And so I did. So for the next 2.5 years or so, I worked as a postdoc up at the National Research Council of Canada. And there I became very unhappy, very dissatisfied. I was doing experiments, because in Canada at that time, that's all there were in chemistry. There were no theoreticians, zero. There were some theoretical physicists, but no theoreticians in chemistry. So everybody who was in chemistry, graduate school, would do experimental work. So I went up there and did a different kind of experimental work. This was high vacuum work, whereas in graduate school, it had been solution kinetics connected with the RDX program, the explosives program, and stuff like that. Although my work was quite unimportant, as it turned out. Nevertheless, we went up there, and it was at that point that I became, after a year or two, very dissatisfied, very unhappy, because here I'd enjoyed all these math courses. I think I'd probably taken more math courses than any other chemist at McGill had. I mean, not now compared with standards now, I'm sure, but then. And here I was essentially using none of them. In other words, the experiments were of the type that there wasn't much theory, or in fact, we didn't know anything about theory. And so a friend and I, he had also been a postdoc, he'd also been a student at McGill working for somebody else, pulled together, and we both had experimental results, and we decided we try to read papers that are on theory. Typically it was Henry Eyring's papers on theories of reaction rates. And we would explain to each other. We each give a two-man seminar. And he would explain to me one time, and the next time I would explain to him. You know, we'd each have select a paper to do that. And that was sort of my first exposure to theory, was reading about that. Although we had had some theory in courses at McGill, but they were taught by this chap who taught practically all the PChem courses, and he wasn't a theoretician. So I'm sure he did a valiant job, probably did as good as you can get, but he wasn't a real theorist. So, you know, I'm sure he couldn't communicate some of the flavor. Nevertheless, he tried. But essentially, we knew no theory, but we did this reading of articles and went. And then if you combine that with all this unhappiness and not being able to use things, I wondered, maybe I should see if I could get another postdoc in theoretical chemistry. And there was nobody to write to in Canada. So there were people in England, there were people in France. In fact, there was a chance of getting a kind of fellowship just after the war to France, but I thought that'd be too frivolous. Can you imagine that, the maturity of that? Too frivolous, and that I really should, you know, stay around and do something more. So I wrote to a half a dozen theoretical chemists in the U.S., and one of them, only one of them, replied favorably, and he said if he could get an Office of Naval Research grant to support my work there, I could come down and work for him. And he applied. This was Oscar Rice. And so that turned out to be a wonderful thing. So the first obstacle was switching from experiment to theory, at least temporarily, mm-hmm. and having difficulty in getting a theoretical position. Anyways, I went to work with Rice and
at
University of North Carolina.
UNC, okay.
And I met my future wife the first week that I was there, and 6 months later we were married. So
wow.
And anyways, she was from North Carolina.
Right.
That turned out to be an absolutely splendid choice. I don't think I could have made a better choice. I mean, that's an example of you might call serendipity, that he was the one who took me on, and it was just a wonderful choice. So one of the things, beside my sitting in on a couple of courses that were theoretical in nature to help learn the theory, once a week he and I would get together, and I could pick some theoretical paper and explain to him what's in the paper, and he would point out maybe assumptions or things like that that I would have missed and so on. And he was a theoretician with a wonderful physical feel for things. In other words, not just formal theory, but a wonderful physical thing. And I'm sure, I mean, for me, that was a natural, and I'm sure that that was just a perfect fit. So, but then after about 2 years, you know, you're married now, you can't just sit around being postdoc. And so that's when I looked around for a position. And that's where the troubles started, because we wrote, my wife and I, she typed them, wrote 35 letters to various universities applying for an academic position. And as I've often said, we didn't get 35 no's because not everybody replied. And so I was, you know, it was discouraging. What am I going to do? So actually, I saw a couple of outstanding people. One was Fritz London, a famous physicist who at that time was a Duke. That was Heitler London thing. They were the sort of the founders of sort of modern potential energy surfaces, essentially. So anyways, London was a Duke in the physics department, and there was a joint symposium, so I met, seminar between Duke and Carolina. And so I spoke with him about the possibility of getting a postdoc, so that was a possibility. I also somehow got to talk with Mulliken, who was up at Chicago, and, talk with him, so there may have been a possibility, I don't know. But if I didn't get an academic job, rather than go to some place that I wouldn't do much research in, it was nothing as far as graduate research essentially, or very little, rather than do that, I was prepared to go on a third postdoc if I could get the right one. But then a friend and I, this is Hans Jaffe, who was a doctoral student of Oscar Rice, and became good friends at Chapel Hill, decided to drive up to the ECS meeting in Cleveland and go to a job fair there. I suspect he was probably looking for a job too. Anyways, he loved to drive long distances, so we went in his car up there. And I saw somebody at a school that I'm sure would not have worked out well because the amount of research was very little and so on. And I think they were interested. But
this is in Cleveland?
This is
Case Western then?
No. This was some other place. Yeah. No, not Case Western. Another. No, if it had been Case Western, I would have.
I was going to. That's
yeah.
Why I went.
No. then there was a student there who had been a student in one of Oscar Rice's classes at Carolina, and he was in a class that I taught for Rice because Rice became ill when I was there. And he had gone to the Polytechnic Institute of Brooklyn before then as a student, and then went to Carolina for his doctorate. Anyways, he bumped into the dean, Dean Raymond Kirk, who was active in the ACS at the time too, of the Polytechnic Institute of Brooklyn, and Kirk told him that they're looking for some faculty members. And this chap had been in this class that I had taught in Rice's illness, and so he recommended me. And so I had an interview with Raymond Kirk, Wonderful, absolutely. We named one of our youngest, in fact, after him, Raymond. I was invited to go up there for an interview, and when we started off, he, before I got around talking with the various people, then they would make their decision. He said that the salary would be between $4,800 and $5,200, and that wasn't bad for that time. It was 1951 and so on, and it was a little bit more than I was making as a postdoc. Probably quite a bit more, and so on. I think it, as a postdoc in Canada, I think it was around 2,400 or something. Anyways, he said that the salary, and then I went around and talked with the various people, and they were interested in what I was doing, because what I had done in theory at Caltech and the experiments I wanted to do. Anyways, afterwards, I think it was maybe I didn't even have to wait to go back, but I don't remember. It's possible I had to go back. But in any case, I was offered a position there. But the salary, it didn't say $4,800. At that point, it was $4,800. And I was so glad, of course, to get that offer, because Brooklyn Poly was a very research-active place, mm-hmm. a lot of young, enthusiastic people, a lot of people from Europe that have been refugees. So that's how I got my first academic job. And so it was that step of getting the first academic job, which it was quite an ordeal. And often when I'm talking to young students, we're eventually going to academia, I try to tell them something about that to show that I know their pain.
It takes resilience. Yeah. So you went there in 1951 and left when?
I left there in 1964.
To go to the University of Illinois.
To go to University of Illinois. And it was at Brooklyn Poly where I wrote further papers on the work that I had done with Oscar Rice mm-hmm. on unimolecular reactions, which is now known as, for many years, as RRKM theory, mm-hmm. a standard theory for unimolecular reactions. And I wrote four papers there. Well, in 51, and they were ready for publication in 52, and so on, while I was there. And I put Rice's name on all of them. And Rice, being what he was, took his name off them. And he said, you did the work, I didn't. And it's true that when I was doing the work, it was largely up at Brooklyn Poly, but also for a large part of it, he had been ill. So, he was in the hospital and hospitalized and so on. So he and I had published one paper together that came out in 51. So for these four papers, he took his name off them. And at the time, I thought, he doesn't think they're good papers. But, that was his decision. So fine, I did. And then later on, I realized that because that was the essence, really, of our camp theory. So later on, I realized, what a generous person he right. was. Now, it's certainly true. He was ill, and I was either in Carolina or part of the family was up at Brooklyn Poly, and I really did do it on my own. Mm-hmm. But I got my start through him, and we, in fact, published the paper together. So that was the first thing. And then after that, that was a strange thing, because so often, except for this ventured to go from Research Council to Carolina, all the other things are sort of automatic. Mm-hmm. He went from grade school to a nearby high school, which happened to be a very good high school. He went from high school to a good university, which happened to be in the same town. He went from that university to up to the Research Council because somebody had been at that university. I mean, it's all right. Almost automatic. I mean, no effort at all. And the first big thing was trying to make the venture into theory, in other words. And the second big jump was getting a position at Brooklyn Poly, which turned out to be an absolutely wonderful place for me. Brooklyn Poly was not all that high related. It was ranked 21st in chemistry departments in the US, which is pretty good. But it was full of enthusiastic, active people. It was a great atmosphere. We didn't have a large number of highly known people, a few, but not a large number, certainly not in chemistry. We had Herman Mark, but, you know, not most of them. And so there is no pressure to feel you're at a top place where there are all sorts of fantastic people or anything like that. You're sort of more or less all equal. So, you know, we acted in, I think, a very normal way. We were just focused on what we were doing, on the research. So in retrospect, I think it turned out for me to be a very good place. Anyways, that's where I did those unimolecular papers. It came out in 52. And then after that, I didn't know what to work on. Here's a theoretician, not knowing what to work on. God, in these years, it'd be a disaster. And so there's one little problem or another. But since I'd been trained as an experimentalist, I'd also built an experimental program in reaction rates. So I had a number of students, right from the word go, doing experimental work. So that kept me going. But I didn't know what to do in theory. It's amazing. Sometimes maybe you're wiser when you're young. But somehow I sensed not to continue in unimolecular reaction rate theory because there are very few experimental data around at that time. Now there are a huge number, but at that time there are very, very little. And so I had the good sense not to just continue with that because it would have been like, you know, just twiddling one's thumbs essentially as far as making extensive contact with the experiment at that time. So I fiddled around with the experimental work, but on my own, fiddled around with this problem, that problem, a little bit, not knowing. And I think this shows the importance of teaching or interacting with students. I was teaching a course in statistical mechanics, and a student in polymer chemistry, a graduate student, asked me a question, whether a certain theory that we were teaching standard textbook theory could be applied to these long chain poly ions, polyelectrolytes. Could it be applied to that under certain conditions? And I thought about it, and it could. So then I got very interested in polyelectrolytes, and I read every book on electricity that I could imagine. At least I looked at them. There were 11 of them. I still remember the number in the Polytechnic Library on electrostatics. And I looked at them because I wanted to do the electrostatics and prove there are three expressions for the free energy in the literature. Are they related? Are they competitive? And so on. And I really had to go deeply into that electrostatics. So I looked at these 11 books that I got a hold of in the library and found the one that sort of meant the most to me. It gave me the best physical feeling was going on. Namely, it took the potential and broke it up to contributions from charges and contributions from polarized, solvent polarized, volume elements and so on. So it was a very physical way of looking at electrostatics. So then I wrote a couple of papers on that in the polyelectrolytes. And then I happened to be in the library. And, you know, in those days, we went to the library a lot and leafing through books or journals. And although this was 1955, I came across a symposium that had taken place at Notre Dame in 1952. And in that symposium was focused on what was called isotopic exchange electron transfer reactions. That was its main focus. Because during the war, there are many people who worked with radioactive isotopes, and then these isotopes were used after the war for countless things of investigating mechanisms, and in this case, using it to follow the rate of electron transfer in these rather simple forms of reaction called isotopic exchange. You just transfer electron, no big change of standard free energy or anything. You know, some of the things that influence the rate a lot, in a sense, you might call them the simplest reaction in all of chemistry. That's That's really what they were when you think about it. I thought that was interesting. And among the articles was one by Bill Libby, who later won the Nobel Prize for his work on radiocarbon dating. Anyways, Libby looked at this electron jump thing, and he said, when an electron jumps from one reactant to another, and so you have an electron transfer reaction, there's no time for the nuclei to move. So that's sort of a process where there's an electronic change with the nuclei held fixed in place is a kind of process that you apply the Frank Condon principle to. I mean, that's really a statement of it. And that principle had originally been used, was developed in the late 1920s, and had been used to interpret spectra, where you shine light on a molecule, the electron jumps, and during the jump, you know, to an excited state, the nuclei don't have time to move. So here was something that had been designed for spectroscopy being applied to a chemical reaction. So often you see things that, you know, just look lovely and you get excited about them. You know, I think science is a wonderful.
So I think it's interesting to me how you found it. It was a symposium in the proceedings that you were leafing through.
Yeah, I wasn't searching for anybody, just leafing through.
They do it a little differently today. You know?
I know that. No, it was just all of this very innocent. Anyways, I was very excited by seeing this novel application. But then, almost right away, I felt uneasy about it. You know, sometimes one may have an intuition about something. It feels right or it doesn't feel right. And in fact, that's sometimes the way I catch errors that some of my coworkers have done, students or postdocs have done in some computation, because some of the results don't feel right. And that's really, you know, worked a number of times. Anyways, this didn't feel right. And at first I wasn't sure, what was it? I mean, the idea of a Frank Condon principle, an electron jump, that part was right. But what he said was that after it jumps, you know, now you have the two charges in a foreign environment, because they're not in the environment they're in the environment they were started in, but that was suited to those charges. Now you got other charges there, and you got a huge increase of energy, you know. And the thing that I realized was, where did that energy come from? This was a thermal reaction. All of a sudden, electron jumps. It required a lot of excess energy because of the environments were the same as the old charges, but not suited to the new charges. Where did it come from? And I realized that Libby, as great as he was, violated the law of conservation of energy. So that was the beginning of electron transfer theory. And then the key question was, what can you do? How can you treat it? And I realized, and all this happened very quickly, that you had to have fluctuations of the dipoles of the solvent and of bond lengths and so on, especially the dipoles of the solvent, before the electron transfer could jump. Because if you had sort of some unusual kind of non-equilibrium condition where you have these fluctuations, then maybe it'd be possible, if you could work out the theory right, that with those fluctuations where the solvation was appropriate neither to reactants nor to products but something in between, that the electron could transfer with no violation of conservation of energy. And that was the central idea, and that was the essence of the 1956 papers. There were two of them, one building up the theory and the other applying it to the reaction.
One of the things that's interesting, I don't want to jump too far and fast ahead, but that was really the fundamental piece of work the 50s that led to 1992's Nobel Prize.
No, that's right. And the interesting thing about it, you know, sometimes you can work on a problem for a year and maybe get somewhere, maybe not, or something, sometimes much less. In this case, from start to finish, it was 1 month. And along the way, another interesting thing, and I'd noticed this in the unimolecular thing too, the first thing that I derived in one of these 1956 papers was a complicated expression. Oh, what experimentalist is going to use a complicated expression? And then I realized, just by using some theorem in vector analysis, divergence theorem, something or other, by doing some little transformation, but with no further approximation, just using a rigorous result, that all of a sudden this big thing collapsed into nothing, essentially. In other words, the expression for the free energy barrier to reaction took on an extremely simple form. And it's partly because of that that the theory has been so widely used. But it's an example of where, you know, people sometimes speak of a eureka moment. And that certainly was, because it was completely unexpected, completely unplanned, just using a little theorem to see if I could simplify something.
What took so long, do you think, for the community to recognize the eureka?
Well, yeah. In the electron transfer theory, we made a number of predictions. And in fact, we wrote them out in a paper discussion of the Faraday Society in 1960. And then we applied it to existing data, what's in the 1960 paper, in a paper I wrote for J. Phys. Chem in 1963. Now, among those predictions was that if you had some reaction that was extremely exothermic, that there's no way of easily juggling the solvation things so as to make it the same energy before and after. And in fact, there's a very simple sort of graphical picture that you can use to understand it. And so that meant that if you had a series of reactions, you varied some substituent, so the reaction became increasingly favorable. Delta G zero, the standard free energy, became increasingly negative. The rate would go faster and faster and faster, and then eventually reach a maximum. And if you lowered it more than that, it should slow down. That was in the equations, very simple equation. You can see it immediately. And so I call that region the inverted effect. And then that was in 1960 when I actually had that. And then in the 63 paper and so on, shortly after that, you know, a number of things of the theory were tested, verified. Like there was something relating the rates of two redox couples, sort of electron transfer for each of them, and the cross reaction. There was a cross reaction relation. So there are many tests of that. I derived in an Office of Naval Research report a corresponding theory for reactions at electrodes, and so there were applications to that related to that, the so to speak, the Tafel slope of the reaction, relation between reactions at electrodes and reactions in solution isotopic exchanges. So there were a number, I think there were about five predictions. So. And four of them, more or less, you know, reasonably quickly, you know, seemed to work out okay. But there was one which was this inverted effect. And many people tried to, you know, people were struck with that. It's sort of an exciting thing, unexpected. Like falling down a cliff and you make it too steep, it's harder to fall, essentially, because of the topology. So, I mean, a cliff is like this. But here we're working with parabolas, so it's the topology that's different. People try to verify it for the next 25 years, and there is no direct verification. There is an indirect one that was discovered. Al Bard, actually, and it may have been Al Bard and Larry Faulkner. I don't remember who the student was. And Al studied some very fast reactions by considering some aromatic ions, aromatic molecules, and he'd rapidly changed the electrode between positive and negative. So you had cation, aromatic cations and aromatic anions. You'd have both of them near each other, and they have excess energy, and so much excess energy that they were in the inverted region. And what happened there was that there's no reaction to form the ground state of those things. But as part of the theory, you could form an excited state. And he found 100% formation of excited states electronically of the products of the electron transfer. So that was the first, you might call it indirect, But that was the first sort of experimental thing. But that was sort of on a side, and there were essentially no, no direct things. In fact, there are lots of trials, testing relation, and for reasons I think people understand now, it didn't work out that way. It flattened off because there are presumably many excited electronic states that can go into, and you didn't see the slowdown of a rate, say, of disappearance reactors.
Lots of tests, lots of indirect verification.
That's right. That's right.
And it takes time too.
And so, 25 years later, there was a famous experiment published. Calcaterra was the student, and Kloss and John Miller were the others. Kloss was an outstanding organic chemist. John Miller, outstanding sort of radiologist thing. So they had they constructed a molecule. The organicers constructed a molecule where you had a donor and acceptor at a fixed bridge. So there are no ways of sort of having them come in contact and find some other route. You had a fixed bridge. And there they found, for the first time, directly the inverted effect. So that was 1984, if I remember rightly, and that was the turning point. And now, whether it was that delay, I have no insight into the Nobel Committee, so I don't know. But anyways, I certainly wasn't campaigning for it or anything like that.
No, it's a mysterious process,
yeah,
I suppose.
So, but eventually it did come.
They did come. And that's got to be quite an experience.
Well, it was for my family. No. No, it really was. By that time, I just assumed I wasn't going to get it. So I wasn't even looking each October to see what happened. I just said, that's it. That's fine. I can get by. Finally, they award it, and the week in Stockholm is probably the best way of visiting Stockholm. And it was just our three sons, my late wife and I, were there, and some friends who had been involved in some of the research at, including Norman Sutton, who, he and I worked together. He was an experimentalist. There is a lot on electron transfer. And John Miller, I think Kloss may have been dead at that point. I'm not sure. Anyways, it was just a great experience. There's something going on all the time. You may go to some university student's party that goes on to 3 o'clock in the morning. I think my wife and I never lasted to more than 1 o'clock in the morning. And then at 9 o'clock the next morning, there might be a press conference or something else. Of course, I remembered one press conference. The questions were primarily directed to the person who won the prize in economics rather than to the rest of us, but that's all right.
Well, your experience, your winning of that award created one of the great highlights for the Electrochemical Society. As you were participating in a symposium at our meeting in Canada, Toronto, Canada.
Right,
which,
that's right.
When that announcement was made, all the Canadian press wanted to know more about this Canadian who just won the Nobel Prize.
Yeah, well, and fondly.
For me, there's a close personal connection to your having won that because the Swedish Academy of Science was trying to track you down and wasn't able to do that at your home. And so they called the meeting, and I got the phone call.
Right.
Of course, they wouldn't tell me why they were calling.
Right. But I understand that as a precaution, the Electrochemical Society, wondering if it's a prank, got the number of the Swedish Academy and called back.
That's correct.
To make sure that it wasn't a prank.
That's correct.
Yeah.
It again, the timing was right. And we really weren't, in the business. I mean, we were protective of our meeting attendees. Yeah. We didn't want to get involved in anything that we didn't know a little bit more about. So there was some precautions taken. And then there was some difficulty too, just from the standpoint of, well, what do we do now? Because they were pretty insistent on speaking to you.
Right, right.
And wouldn't tell us all the reasons why.
Right, right.
Because of the confidentiality
of your first conversation
right, with them.
Right.
Well, once we figured all that out and sent myself and our president at the time, Wayne Worrell, and Larry Faulkner, came to the symposium, tapped you on the shoulder.
Right.
Shoulder.
Right. Was it Larry who did? I didn't remember.
Yes,
okay.
He was, yeah. Yes.
Right. Well, he was a cool customer.
Yeah.
Because I had just finished giving a talk at one of the symposia. I was involved in two symposia at that meeting. Just finished giving a talk at one of them. And, of course, it was polite. You know, stay on, hear the next talk, and so on. Not leave just after your own talk. So I was sitting there listening to the thing. And then somebody tapped me on the shoulder. I mentioned who. And then said, there's an urgent message for you. And being a father of three boys, immediately I was dreading it. Something's happened to one of the boys. So we started walking along. And then, like I said, Larry, you say, said, it's good news. I wonder, what kind of good news is it? I was not thinking about the Nobel Prize at all. I mean, I was not following it at all. What kind of good news is this? Well, maybe they're giving me some award. You know, I'd received this Electrochemical Society lecture some years before, I think, and so on. Maybe they're giving me some award. And I thought, but that doesn't sound right, because by that time I had received many awards, and each time, you know, they write you ahead of the meeting or call you that ahead of any meeting, no matter what the society is, and they'll let you know to be sure you're there. And I hadn't received any such call. So that didn't make sense. And I still hadn't thought in terms of Nobel or anything like that. And then he said, after saying it was good news, it's from Stockholm. Then, of course, I knew, and then, of course, after, so then I went and, you know, spoke with the person who was from the head of the Swedish Academy of Sciences, and he told me about it and all. So, of course, it was splendid. And, of course, the first thing I wanted to do is get in touch with my spouse and with the three boys. And so I tried to reach her, but nobody was at home in Pasadena. So I left messages on their answering machines, you know, each of them. In her case, she was down visiting her family in Greenville, North Carolina. She's from the South. And the three boys are at various universities, one thing or another, Indiana, what have you. Anyways, it was the most frustrating thing for several hours not to speak with an immediate member of the family. But the society itself responded immediately, because I remember they scheduled a sort of maybe it was a question and answer thing or a discussion thing in a big, big room at the Royal York Hotel where the meeting was being held. And also, although I didn't know whether it was the society or the hotel that did this, I had a small room at this Royal York Hotel. And immediately, I was put into the Queen's Suite, and I realized that because of the Electrochemical Society, I was put there. And I hadn't realized there was such a royal suite around. So that was quite an experience.
We had a celebrity.
Yeah.
It was. Yeah, the hotel really stepped in. Well, you know, it was amazing, and I don't know, maybe these things go out on the news wire, but not too long after you took the phone call, the hotel was trying to schedule this big press conference. And because you were from Montreal, the Canadian press corps was fascinated and couldn't get there soon enough.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, it seemed like just several hours after, I guess we waited till the symposia was over so you could go back and do what you had to do. But we had this enormous press conference, as you said.
Yeah.
It was, just came out of nowhere. And in the meantime, I thought it was funny, of course, Caltech was informed.
Yes.
They have an outstanding people who handle
the PR. They immediately sent somebody up
right.
to
And they were like, well, don't do anything until we get there. It's like, we can't help it.
Yeah, no, they flew up somebody immediately.
Yeah.
And he handled the...
Yeah,
but moving from this tiny room to this Royal Suite was quite a transformation. It made getting the prize worthwhile.
Well, and another thing, and I mean, this is what I think made it such a highlight for the Electrochemical Society, was what we had this reception that I think the hotel put on. They just said they wanted to do something to honor you. And everybody at the meeting, unannounced, everybody at the meeting was there. And I think you stood all night signing programs and meeting badges and meeting everybody. Who was at the meeting, which had, I don't know, 1,500 people. So it was really a special moment. And even, interestingly enough, some of the after effects, I was in my first year as executive director.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and to have this thing happen and make the meeting so special. And we were also about to launch our first copy of Interface Magazine. And we had our first scoop, which is still... Our most significant scoop that we've had. So you made the cover of the magazine, and we haven't had bigger news since. But it's, you know, what a way to get that off the ground. So just a lot of special things that occurred within the organization as a result of the
timing. Remember the contrast between all of this, you know, wonderful response at Toronto, the people, the society, the hotel, a tremendous response. And then I was scheduled to give a talk at University of British Columbia in Vancouver. And so then when I left the meeting, I then went on this plane to go to Vancouver. And I guess the people in the personnel there, the pilots, others, that nobody knew anything about the Nobel Prize. So it was such a contrast to go from this meeting where there's, you know, everything way up in the air and so on, to go to something where you're completely incognito and so on. It was quite a tremendous contrast.
You went there immediately after Toronto.
Yeah, that's right, because I was committed to, give a talk at UBC, in British Columbia. And so I just continued. But going from that tremendous activity to essentially the inactivity, lack of any sort of response of anything, going from Toronto to British Columbia is quite a contrast. And,
Well, maybe we could go to a little bit about after you win the Nobel Prize, and that's 1992, so it's many years later. Kind of influence have you seen in your work, applications today, things you're having as a result?
Well, of course, the electron transfer theory has had many applications in photosynthesis. The inverted effect may be one of the factors that helps make the plant photosynthesis or bacterial photosynthesis more efficient, because it cuts down a competitive, very exothermic back reaction, you see. There, I think, another factor too, but it's a factor there. It plays a role in many of these solar cells, you know, energy transfer between dye or some absorber and something else. So there are many areas where, electron transfer theory is applied. And nowadays there's work on nanoparticles, so now you can do work where the diffusion layer is very thin because the particles are small size, and you can observe some effects that with bulk electrodes would be difficult to observe. Namely, you could cover a bigger range of the current voltage plot for some electron transfer process in electrode without running into, at the higher limit, it becoming rapidly diffusion controlled because of the diffusion layer there, and that's sort of a limit. But if you have practically no diffusion layer, as you do in these nanoparticles, then you can get at this thing more directly. Well, one of the consequences of that, and there's a chap at MIT who's written about it now, and I think it's becoming increasingly known, is that in early electrochemical days, around 1930, there's the famous Butler-Volmer theory for the current versus potential. And basically, it's a theory which says that the current depends exponentially on the overpotential, essentially, with some arbitrary constant that fits the data called the Tafel constant. So, and that has been commonly used in many things in electrochemistry. But nowadays you can get into the curved region just because of the nanoparticles. So now, as I understand it, there's an increasing use of an electron transfer formula that has that curved region, you see. So instead of the Butler-Volmer, I think what you're going to find is that people are going over more to a more fundamental theory, which has this curvature in it. And that was the electron transfer theory that I gave, and subsequently improved by others to consider in detail all sorts of distribution, you know, transfer into all sorts of different states of the metal, say, allowing for, you know, the polyexclusion principle, you know, distribution of electrons and so on. So the main thing is that nowadays, I think this is one change. I haven't followed the field closely, but I think this is one change that with the increasing sort of application to these other types of systems where the curvature stands out more because you can cover a bigger range of potential, that's certainly a change that's gone on. But probably there's still quite a few people who use the simpler equation, which has a straight line for log of the current versus potential, instead of a curved line, so on. But I mean, that's one example, but that's a very recent example.
I have a question here that is I'm supposed to be asking about your future and the enthusiasm that you have, which I think you just already answered. What keeps you so enthusiastic is obviously all the different possibilities.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Well, you know, it all comes back to the puzzles, I think, and the enjoyment of puzzles as a child and so on. I don't think that's changed. Only now the puzzles are scientific puzzles. And the thing is that you may hear about some experimental result. Maybe it's the intermittent fluorescence of semiconductor quantum dots and that distribution of fluorescence lifetimes in that intermittency obeys a certain unusual law, it's called a power law, so on. Or maybe it's some work that that Barry Sharpless did, where he took two organic liquids that were immiscible, and the reaction, it was a cycloaddition reaction, took, let's say for this pair, 48 hours. Then he took those same two liquids and shook it up with a lot of water, and the reaction took 10 minutes. So how do you explain that? And there have been puzzles like that, you know, all along. Or right now, a recent thing that we had a theory for that, or developed a theory for that upon seeing the experiment, and it was based on connecting that observation with something that I had remembered from study of surface processes using some frequency generation that told you something about the composition of the surface. And in the case of you had a water surface, you had quite a few OHs that couldn't hydrogen bond, not geometrically, it wasn't possible, you just couldn't do it. So you had them sticking out. So if those OHs sort of were more attracted to the transition state of the reactants than to the reactants, you get an acceleration. It would lower the energy more one than the other. And so a former postdoc and I, he did the work, calculated that, and it turned out that that was enough to explain this huge acceleration. So there is another puzzle, you see, that prompted us to do work. So it's that sort of thing. Or another thing, this happened in around 2000, there's work, there's a very unusual distribution of isotopes of oxygen in the stratosphere. Normally, if you look at distribution of oxygen isotopes, the 16, 17, 18, in everything that's on the surface of the Earth, whether it's in the Earth itself, you know, those rocks, or whether it's in the CO2 that's around here on the Earth, or whether it's in water, almost anything, or minerals, anything. When it's down near Earth, you plot one isotope ratio of those three versus another isotope ratio, the slope is almost invariably close to 1/2. But up in the stratosphere, that particular thing, the slope is 1. And so I wondered, how can you explain that? You know, what's special? And what's evolved in the atmosphere is an oxygen atom that's formed by dissociation of UV of an oxygen molecule, collides with an oxygen molecule, you form an ozone molecule. Most of those will dissociate because they have so much energy, but a few will collide with something before, and you get stabilization. So that's sort of the mechanism. So I applied RKM theory, as had other people before me. That didn't work. And then I realized that, well, if the statistical assumption of RKM theory breaks down, and if you have partly non-statistical behavior, then if you look at what having these different isotopes and their statistics and so on would do, that you could explain it. And not only that, you could explain it. I mean, there's one study by a chap in Germany which had this isotopic distribution, because you could do it in the lab too, for all sorts of combinations of 16, 17, and 18. So he had a whole bunch of mass spec there with their populations. And we applied this theory to it, and it worked very well, and so on. I mean, there's one unknown parameter, how much deviation from statistical behavior from RKM, and hopefully eventually that'll be determined, you know, independently from other sources. But that was an example of another observation that had been in the literature. In fact, that observation was in the literature in 1983. That was when it was first discovered. And then I heard about it around 1999, I think, or 98. So there was an observation that hadn't been explained, and here was what I believe, and I think many others believe, was a reasonable explanation, you see. So typically, I think what gets me going is hearing about these little puzzles of things. It's sort of like, again, it's like childhood in a way, but different kind of puzzle.
Well, you said you enjoyed puzzles in your first childhood, and I think you said you're in your second childhood, enjoy puzzles.
It could be the third.
Okay, whatever it is, you still like the puzzles.
Yes, very much so, yeah.
I want to turn to and conclude with some of your thoughts about, you touched on many, many things today, and the importance of electrochemistry and the different areas that it's touching now that are so relevant in energy and water and biomedical and communications.
No, absolutely.
And so we're...
there are many groups that are working on all sorts of, you know, to try to harness sunlight or try to harness fuels and fuel cells or what have you. So there's a tremendous amount of work there.
And so as a professional society trying to serve this discipline, what do you think we can do better to hopefully advance the science even faster?
Yeah. Well, of course, for me, an important thing was reading journals. So having top flight journals that have recent things that have high standards that are able to separate quality, although that may be difficult to separate early on until something
absolutely
gets used.
Is.
That's certainly important. Having journals that are reasonably accessible to people that don't cost a tremendous amount. Universities are often struggling for funds. And probably a number of them had to cut back on their library funds, for example. So anything you can do there to make things less expensive, I think, is important. Anything you can do to—I don't know how you can do it—encourage people to think deeply and not just produce a lot of sort of the same sort of stuff. It's very easy in this age, especially this computer age, to generate a tremendous amount of somewhat similar stuff, and you get high productivity, big publication lists, but then you have to ask yourself, what is novel about that? Of course I'm biased, but I figure that a very influential paper is surely worth more than 100 or maybe even 1,000 a fairly routine paper. So the more people have the opportunity to think about things or hear about puzzles, I don't know how the society can say, all right, here's a puzzle, here's a puzzle, here's a puzzle. Because sometimes it's difficult to recognize. You know, once you recognize that there's a problem there, that's a good part of getting the solution.
Right, yeah. But you sort of already pointed to that. We can't do that, but yeah. What we can do is try and make the information as available as possible. Yeah. Because you, during this short conversation, we talked about, you know, a paper that you found in 1920 and 1999.
Yeah, that's right.
And just make the information
sure,
available.
Sure, that's right. And you know, I'm always sort of amazed at times. Sometimes I, you know, start looking around here in the literature, one following one thing up, and I'm just amazed at how much of the literature I don't know, because there's so much literature now. And how do you distill from that?
Right.
Because it may be difficult to recognize at the time what's important, what isn't. I mean, some things are striking, sure. Like the stuff of Sharpless, that was striking, or the stuff that I mentioned, it was Mark Tiemens who did it. At University of California, San Diego, on this anomalous isotope effect, you know, in the stratosphere in the laboratory. He did the laboratory part. How do you recognize things like that amidst the huge number of papers? I don't know the answer to that, because in part it may be necessary to do a lot of maybe many papers so that some of the generalities might emerge from them,
right.
You say. You know, it's not completely.
It's a tough
not every paper can be
no,
a genius paper.
It yeah. can't be. And yeah. I know the Electrochemical Society has a role as a curator, but you're
yeah.
right. It's that's a hard one.
Right. But certainly bringing people together focused on things, whether it's fundamental or applied, that the Electrochemical Society is done a lot, and that's certainly an important thing to proceed, and somehow doing what it can to try to develop increasingly insightful things. It's true, routine things can accumulate and provide something that you might look at and say, oh, there's a pattern, something like that. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, so not every paper can be a breakthrough paper.
Well, you certainly made it exciting for the people we brought together in 1992.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to thank you for sharing that moment with us.
Yes.
And your work, your experience, mm-hmm. your friends and colleagues mm-hmm. and your family. And thank you for all of this today. Really appreciate it.
Well, good to talk with you. And, of course, wonderful to have been there and at the Electrochemical Society meeting in 1992. Unexpected surprise.
Yeah. Well, thanks.
Thank you.